Okay, good morning, everyone. It's always fun to do the 8 a.m. session after the first night of the hospitality suites and lounges. Thanks for sharing your morning with us. The only thing more fun is doing it on Thursday after you've had two nights of the hospitality lounges and vendor parties. I'm John Pescatore with the SANS organization, and we're going to spend the next 45 minutes on a really cool topic. It's a lot in the press about how many jobs are opening in cybersecurity, but the focus is always on quantity, not on the actual skills gap, and not actually on a couple other things we want to talk about that we've got a really nice panel set up here for you. So let me sort of set the stage here. I joined SANS about 5 years ago, 2013, after almost 14 years as Gartner's lead security analyst. And each year I worked with, typically 1,000 to 2,000 of the Fortune 10,000 companies. I began to notice a couple of things. They all had access to the same technology and information. You know, there's a magic quadrant of typical Gartner thing or a Forrester thing on different technology choices companies can make to let the good guys in and keep the bad guys out. And it also turns out that within a given industry, all you guys spend about the same as each other as far as a percentage of IT or percent of revenue. Very different between different industries. There's a SANS survey up there, so finance spends a lot more than, say, healthcare in security. But within finance, everybody's pretty much in this narrow range of spending about as much as each other. And in fact, on the staffing numbers, it's very similar as well as far as a percent, security bodies as a percent of the IT staff or a percent of the employee headcount within a given vertical industry. So the spending's the same, the access to information technology's the same, the people staffing levels are the same, yet the results are very different. I'd be dealing with Gartner clients in pharmaceuticals, and one of them would show up like a Merck or somebody that had a $300 million exposure to WannaCry because they got creamed by WannaCry. Yet another pharmaceutical company didn't have that, or a transportation company that did not have a breach, a major breach, and did not make the numbers. So same access to information and money, yet very different resources. So I began to wonder, you know, what is the difference? And I started to look into, while I was still at Gartner, before I came to SANS, what the difference, whoops, we lost something here. What the difference was, let me use the right way to advance the slides here. There we go. So I started looking at some of the data, and one source I like to look at is the Identity Theft Resource Clearinghouse, because they measure the numbers each year, the resource center. And last year, we had 1,579 publicly declared breaches, and that's about a 50% growth since 2016. We were doing really well last year until Equifax skewed the numbers with what it ended up with, about 150 million. But that still means, even if there were 1,600 breaches, 8,400 companies in the Fortune 10,000 and government agencies were not on that list. They did something to not have a major public breach. Another thing I look at is what's the size of the breaches. So last year, oh, by the way, if you're interested, I just looked it up this morning. This year, as of April 1st, we've had 273 publicly declared breaches. That would extrapolate to about 1,100 for this year, which would be a good year, until they add Facebook, if they count that as a breach. Then the numbers are just going to get skewed upwards. Because the next parameter I look at is the average size of the breach, because it's one thing to have a breach, it's another thing to maybe notice it right when it starts or when smaller systems are breached before the customer jewels are breached. So last year was a horrible year. The number went up to 113,000 records per breach, which is about a $10 million incident for anybody that experienced that average size breach. Now in 2016, the number had actually gone down from 2015. There were things being done better. The Equifax numbers did skew it. When you remove the big whales like the Equifax breach, you found that a lot of companies were still doing better. There were smaller companies getting breached, but a lot were managing to notice faster, respond more quickly, and reduce the business impact of the breach. So as I started each year, follow these numbers and start to look into the differences, I found the real differentiator was the quality of the security team in the organization, the quality of the CISO and the quality of the team. And the evidence of quality was the team's ability to change things, to get IT to do something differently, to convince management to do basic security hygiene or strong authentication or other things that, to evince change. And another common thing I noticed was the better security teams had worked together longer. They weren't, everybody was there for 2 years and they all were job hopping it for 2 years. They were generally promoted from within, which meant the company was able to find people at sort of the SOC analyst level, the operational level, and then get them trained so they not only know security but know the company, and then they move up the food chain within the company and be able to be part of that stronger team. So that began to sort of focus in on the differences there, and we start to see some data come about. This is an ISACA study from 2017 that said everybody talks about, you know, the difficulties in hiring. Well, 25% of the respondents say the candidates they were receiving are lacking in skills, and more like 60% say what they're missing, 70%, what the candidates are missing is hands-on experience and technical knowledge or certification of technical knowledge. So again, if you're hiring people from each other compared to bringing somebody in at the operational technical level and then them growing into a higher level security analyst, knowing both your company, the threats, and security basics, you're going to be part of one of those stronger security teams. So SANS kicked off a number of efforts to help feed into the bottom of that pipeline. How do we get younger people, lower level people interested in security? How do we determine who has the promise to be a critical security contributor? So that's the sort of lead into our panel here. And I'm going to toss it over to Alan Paller. He's first going to talk about finding those young people and moving them up the chain. Then James Lyne will come on and detail the SANS program. And Joe Roundy will talk some practical experience at Montgomery College in Maryland.
Thanks, John. My job is to show you that there is a way to find people who are extremely curious, extremely tenacious, and who learn very fast. How many of you don't like those on your staff? Just think about the three people you love, who you work with. Curious, tenacious, and learn really fast. You don't have to teach it to them seven times. They go look it up themselves. They stay with a problem until it's finished rather than leave it to you. You know those people? So if we could find those people a priori and put them into the loop, we might find something interesting changing in the cybersecurity field. So I'm going to show you a game. The game is called CyberStart, and it is a game, and I'm going to make 5 claims that are completely outrageous. No game does this, but read them with me. One is it finds talent in people who didn't know they had it. Two is it delights the people who are curious, tenacious, and quick learners. That means it separates them. The other people quit. The ones who are the ones we want stay with it. Three, it's great in rural areas. It's great in urban areas. It's great in places that have no techie teachers and no great computer science teachers. It's just as good at working where there is no resources. Four, it changes their mind about going into STEM careers. Changes their mind from I'm not interested to, oh my goodness, I think I'd be interested in this. And five, it actually teaches them the foundations on which great security careers are taught. Those are 5 claims. I could sit down now and you would say that's baloney. So I'm going to show you the actual statements from the teachers and students who played. So 15 governors got together in January and announced a program with us called Girls Go CyberStart. They did that because the boys program we did, the open program we did last summer, only got 7% girls, and we said that's crazy. So the girls didn't want to play because it was an unfair playing field. Do you notice the numbers in this room? Can you see why they might think it's an unfair playing field, right? So they just didn't, why should I play a game that I'm going to lose because the boys have all been trained in this stuff. So this program, the 17 governors got 6,550 girls to sign up in 17 days, and it was going up at 500 a day when we cut it off. So it probably would have been 50 or 60,000 had we allowed it to go another 3 weeks, but we had to get to the game. And the girls liked it, and they liked it enough that they made thank you cards for their governors. This is the first governor that got this was Hogan, and this is his card. And I think we gave you each one of these. If you didn't, hold your hand up, and they'll hand you one. Because it's just too hard. Did anybody not get one?
They're not allowed to. They'll get them on the way out.
They'll get them on the way out? You'll get them on the way out. Okay.
Health and safety.
Right. But I'm gonna since you're gonna get them, I'm not gonna take a lot of time to read this. But I just made 5 claims. Let's just take those claims and prove them, and then I'll turn it over to James. One is it finds talent who didn't think they were capable. Read the second one. Before I recruited girls to be part of this program, I struggled to get them to realize they could be computer scientists. I had girls saying they were too stupid to do this, so I said, just try it. Some of my girls found out they were good at puzzles. Some found out they liked programming. I now have girls asking our counselor about computer science degrees. Does that sound like a change? So of the girls, 844 filled out a questionnaire about the game, and on the left, you'll see the data. It says that before we played this game, about 36% were interested in STEM careers, and after it was 70%. That was a 6-day program. Tell me another thing that does that. Anything even close, right? And these are what the teacher said. The middle one really matters. The contest, what she called a contest, gave them the why and how to use knowledge about computer science, and that's what they needed to get excited about it. Meaning playing it, doing it, using it got them excited, not somebody standing up in front of them lecturing at them about how cool it is. Third, the tenacious word, the second one is better. The final weekend of the challenge was the beginning of our school vacation week. 3 of the 4 girls spent most of Saturday and Sunday in my classroom. There aren't too many things that would get high school students to sacrifice 2 days of their vacation to work on education. Sound a little like tenacious, right? They didn't have anything better to do. And rural schools, the second one again is really quite good. Actually, both of these, my students were able to participate in something they normally had no knowledge in our rural area. At first, they were unsure. By the end, they were yelling and jumping up and down as they were finishing a challenge and moving on to the next one. But the other one's actually a little more moving. So rarely any opportunities like this for someone like me who knows nothing about cybersecurity, where I get to learn about it, love everything about it. I hope that an opportunity like this will come again, not only to me, but to all those who've been waiting for this golden opportunity in their lives. That's a note to his governor, or her governor. And one of the governors told me, hey, Alan, I never get notes like this. I get notes asking for things, and I get notes that hate me. And these are actually kind of positive notes. Last one for mine is, I was with the team from Padua Academy, which is a Delaware team. They were 7th in the nation out of 2,700 teams that played in this competition in February. The youngest player was a sophomore, and I was standing across a table in the Google room or the Cisco room or something at the Women in Cybersecurity Conference, and I had 3 of them there, and I said, did you all do all the competitions, or did you specialize? And the girl in the middle, who was a sophomore, said, we specialized. And I said, okay, what was your specialty? And she said, Linux. And just play that one out in your mind for a second. Linux, high school girl, sophomore. Where did she learn Linux? Think she's a secret hacker? And I asked her, where'd you learn Linux? And she looked at me the way, as at my age, I get this a lot. Young people look at really old people like they're not of the same planet, like, do you not understand? And she said, well, I learned it in the game. The game teaches you everything you need to know. She had never touched Linux 6 days before, the day she started it, never. And they were the 7th ranked team in the nation. So did I prove the points about the 5 points? I mean, it just blew me away. I showed this to my wife, and she said, whatever we have to do, we're gonna make sure every kid in the country gets a chance to do this, because they're going to find out what they're really good at. Anyway, I didn't do this. Oh, I do have one more slide, because the problem with this is it's all about girls. We did run one with 7 states last summer for students over 16, which was almost all boys, as I said. And this is all the governors each got a report. All these reports are at cyberstart.us. So if you want to read any of the governor's reports or that picture. But look at the 2 bottom ones on the boys. I learned how to reverse engineer strip binaries. How many people can reverse engineer strip binaries? This is a game for kids. She learned Linux, he learned how to reverse engineer. And the last one, even as a 5th-year computer science student at a good school, George Mason has a really good computer science program, I was learning new things. I especially liked how it encouraged you to do the research necessary to solve the problems. It didn't just teach you how to do everything. Curious, tenacious, That's what we're after. Okay, so I didn't do this. It would be hard to say this many positive things about something I did. It would be embarrassing. But the guy who actually did build it is here. His name's James Lyne. He's going to be keynoting the whole RSA in a few minutes, and he still thinks this is important enough to come talk about. So, James, you want to talk about this?
Well, good morning, everyone, and pleasure to be here. Thank you for that introduction, Alan. It's kind of a strange feeling to sit here and look at some of those quotes. But I was grinning for two reasons. The first was because it's just such a joy to hear of a young student enjoying, you know, reverse engineering stripped binaries. I teach a lot of classes on kind of advanced exploit development and penetration testing. And I have a lot of adults that get extremely angry and miserable over reverse engineering strip binaries. And here you have a kid that of their own volition enjoys this. You know, just really exciting for me. The other reason was this morning when I went to order my coffee, I asked to have the ICAR test virus string put on as my name. And I just noticed, having read it out, that they just put Ben, which I thought was a wonderful opt-out. So I want to tell you guys a story of how this stuff kind of came to be and some of the things we've been up to over the past few years to develop this. It all started 3 or 4 years ago in the UAE and in the UK in parallel, when a group of customers came to us and said, we not only need to find more people to put into a series of intern and cybersecurity development programs, we also need to find a more diverse group of people. They were already running programs to try and create talent in response to the fact that they just couldn't hire enough people with 5 years' experience from the existing talent pool. But they were finding time and time again that they were either finding the same type of people that would succeed in small numbers, or they were inviting people in and seeing them fail. They had really poor conversion rates through these programs. So the very first scenario, we were asked to put together something that would entice 11 to 18-year-olds and try and bring a more diverse group of kids into an interest in cybersecurity. Just push them over the line of realizing this stuff was fun and engaging. That was it. And we had about 5 weeks to do it. So we ordered, I think, about 400 Raspberry Pis. And went through the process of trying to get them over a border with customs, which was mightily interesting indeed, and found a merry set of developers and designers that were prepared to drink just inhumane volumes of coffee to try and produce a version one prototype. And it was our hypothesis that making a game, making this stuff fun, and applying abductive principles, going back from the things that we all do day to day as security professionals, to simple axiomatic logical processes, and slowly building them up, would teach people this stuff was more accessible, more fun, and more engaging than punching them in the face repeatedly with theory, which is what we often tend to do, and something that works badly with 11 to 18-year-olds. So we built this version one, and it was awful. I mean, it was so bad. I sometimes get it out and kind of show people, and you know, it makes me feel so sad compared to the shiny version that we have today. The graphics were just awful. I mean, they let me write quite a substantial portion of the UI. And trust me, that is a terrible idea. It looked like 1990s Netscape Navigator had come back to the party, right? And there was a wonderful bug on the Raspberry Pis where if you completed all of the challenges, it would show some confetti. But the confetti had a rendering bug that would cause the CPU on the Raspberry Pis to run so hot they would turn off and basically melt, which was awesome. I'm kind of proud of it. But despite all the terrible implementation details, we learned that kids could very quickly be converted to being interested in believing in themselves. Day one, these kids turned up, 600 of them, and they were very disinterested. They'd been forced in the middle of their school holidays to come to a computing camp, forced being the operative word. And on day two, these 600 kids turned up an hour and a half early for school. There is no greater form of flattery than children turning up early to school. I mean, it just doesn't get better than that. I watched this one girl in particular. She was 9. So way too young for the program, and she'd been kind of oisted into this program along with her sibling. Her parents had dropped her off, and she sat there on day one, working through, just trying to register in a web browser to get started with the challenges we'd put together. And she was really struggling. She was working with this older girl sat next to her, who was about 14, 15 years old. I came back halfway through day one, and noticed there was a bit more independence. She was working on some challenges, still going backwards and forwards, doing some rudimentary kind of web application challenges. Fairly impressive stuff. I came back on day two around lunchtime, and I watched her set a breakpoint at a kind of careful point in this JavaScript code, obfuscated JavaScript code, to evaluate a set of unencrypted variables being passed as part of a login procedure to be able to inspect and modify them. So she developed, fairly intuitively, a set of debugging skills, basically from sitting in a classroom and playing a game and using a search engine and reading articles online, which is amazing. And what's more, she'd stopped talking to the person next door and was kind of proudly racing away, trying to earn points to be able to overtake the person next to her. This kind of wonderful sense of competition had kicked in. It was at that point I realized that the kind of amazing potential of this stuff, and also, frankly, felt really, really stupid. I mean, I spent a long time working really hard trying to learn these skills, and here we had a set of kids brute force computational machines learning things at a faster pace than, you know, I ever did as a kid. So I felt really stupid but really proud of that at the same time. We went on to develop a version 2, a version 3, following the same principles, fixing the confetti bug. You know, we stopped melting Raspberry Pis, building a much more substantial base of content, and introducing narrative. We took a lot of lessons from the gamification principles that have been applied to the world of gaming. We introduced a badge system, so people had micro-achievements to incentivize them to keep moving. We wrote a truly bizarre narrative where we started teaching the application of these skills and ethics through the leveling up process of the game. So as they would solve a web application challenge, they would be given clues about the dealings of a nefarious criminal gang online. And they'd be using these clues to slowly sleuth more information to aid the international authorities in taking this criminal gang down. The criminal gangs are quite bizarre. My personal favorite is the Choppers, a Norwegian criminal gang who are set on stealing all of the trees in Norway. I think I drove one of our web designers slowly insane in forcing him to come up with bizarre narratives of cyber criminals that didn't involve actual real crimes, which was quite challenging. So we kind of worked through this process, and I'll double back to where we've got to shortly, because I want to tell you about one other initiative that happened in parallel. We found that there's a real fork point with kids in this 11 to 18 bracket, around 14 or 15, where their approach to reasoning, their self-awareness of careers, their preconceived notions of jobs, and frankly, of just whether or not something is interesting, becomes much more set and developed. We found at a younger age, it was much, much easier to bring in far more diverse groups of people. We found at some of the older end of the spectrum that it was more challenging because of those preconceived notions. So we set about a project to try and take a group of people that had been down different paths to cybersecurity to identify if those people that had gone and done different things actually could have the right raw talent to pivot across to the cybersecurity industry and to try and understand what makes a good cybersecurity practitioner. Now, it's a particularly challenging project. I mean, we're guilty of it even at RSA here sometimes, where we sometimes collapse an entire industry of hundreds of roles down to kind of one shape and size person that we call a cybersecurity practitioner. So we went and did an extensive survey of SANS instructors, of industry experts, people that we thought were really effective at their role. We talked to penetration testers, we talked to forensic analysts, and we tried to break down a set of simple traits for each of them that enabled them to be really good at what they did. And we started on a relatively non-scientific basis. We shored it up thereafter as some of this stuff kind of proved to be valid. We looked at, you know, how they consumed information. We looked at the behaviors that enabled them to accumulate these vast tomes of knowledge that were required to be effective in their discipline. And we started building these trait profiles that described them. There were traits in there like parsing. We found that a very large number of cybersecurity professionals with hands-on keyboard skills are capable of parsing information in very different ways to the average individual. Some of them will look at a wall of unstructured text and will immediately flick to the interesting portion of it. They just see it, right? It's a superpower. Others will have this byte-by-byte analysis where they will, with painstaking patience, step through until they find something interesting. Others will look at it and go, yeah, that doesn't make any sense, and hit next. Probably the more sane group of people. So we took these traits and we surveyed over 25,000 people across the UK, both in STEM subjects at university, as well as people that were just, you know, doing other interesting jobs, in particular in the age bracket of 16 through to 30. We took these 25,000 data points and we worked through a process of trying to match people with aptitude, traits for success, through to profiles that made them look like the security practitioners we already had. The goal was to ignore knowledge, to ignore skill, and to look at the raw behaviors that could lead to success. And we found, from those 25,000 people, a group of about 600 that really, really looked good. We brought them into an interview, and we whittled down to a group of around 100 students that we thought could be successful cybersecurity practitioners. We then put them in a room for 8 to 10 weeks and bombarded them with cybersecurity fundamentals, with foundation knowledge. We built a curriculum that you'll hear much more about very shortly that focused on rapidly teaching them networking fundamentals, application and engineering fundamentals, programming disciplines, just a wealth of different IT and computing constructs to enable them to quickly pivot to absorbing cybersecurity material. The short version of the story, of those 100 odd people that we put through these two consecutive programs, one of which was funded by the UK government, almost every one of them has ended up in a cybersecurity career. In fact, it's only two that have gone back to a general IT career. I still kind of regard that as a win. Some of them working in organizations like NATO and police forces, doing forensic stuff. There's one who's in the Google Bug Hall of Fame, having discovered a couple of Android kernel flaws. I mean, they've gone on to do incredibly impactful things. That one in particular was a bartender before they entered this program, 10 weeks later in cybersecurity. Another one that's accomplished some amazing things as part of this program was working as a genius in an Apple store fixing people's iPhones, and is now teaching advanced reverse engineering skills kind of 3 or 4 years later. So I guess what I want to get across from all these things developing is that by looking at what good looks like and finding more diverse and captivating ways to hook people into these programs, we can show a much wider range of people that they can do this. We can surprise them with how good they are at cybersecurity without these preconceived notions. The culmination of these programs I've described, this year we've worked with DCMS in the UK, it's a division of the British government, and we launched a program to deploy CyberStart Game out across the whole country. In the first run, we've managed to get over 23,000 students to spend kind of tens to hundreds of hours on the game here, developing these skills, finding a pool of several thousand elite students that are now demonstrating some of the skills that we as cybersecurity practitioners care about. So it works. It's happening. It's real. We're finding amazing talent. And personally, whilst I'm incredibly, incredibly proud of the things that have been accomplished here, I'm also slightly terrified because I can see a huge number of incredibly talented people that are set out as a next generation to make me look really, really stupid. And I'm fantastically happy about that. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Joe here. John, you're going to do the introduction.
Can you sync the slides? He just decided not to use the slides.
Oh, yes, I had slides. Slides are overrated. You enjoyed my story, though, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, thank you. I am Joe Roundy. I'm the Cybersecurity Program Manager at Montgomery College. I've got about 30 years experience in operational IT, and about more than half of that was in IT security. In fact, I was the manager of IT security for the college for about 9 years before I decided to join the dark side and go to the academic function of the college. To all the points previously made, what I saw when I got there being taught was the old guy talking about the theoretical aspects of cybersecurity and IT. And then we would test you on that. And what we're seeing, we see a lot of students who come back to Montgomery College, a two-year school, saying, I have a master's degree in cybersecurity, I can't find a job. No one will hire me because I've not actually touched anything. So they're coming back and we're trying to implement those classes. And we've been doing this for about 10 or 15 years, actually. A little less in the theoretical and lecture, a little more on the hands-on, but when John and Alan and I had a conversation about a year and a half ago about this material, we decided we would try to get it into and make it a class at Montgomery College. Using the content that's been developed by James and his team, because we really felt it would be beneficial, obviously. I've hired people. You probably all hired people, and if they can't answer the questions on how do you do something, then you move on. You check the educational box, and now what have you done? So I was able to get this course into the curriculum as an exploratory course last semester of the fall and this semester. It will be a permanent course going forward. And we use the CPA game as a test for the students before they could get in. And they had access to it for about 2 months before the semester started. It was very educational, not surprising to me, honestly, but very educational in the aspect that I gave out 45 access codes to the game. And to the prior points, what we found were that students who really wanted to be in the class really worked at being in the class. 20 students reached the level that we decided was acceptable, which was level 6 and a score of 12,000. Of the 45 that we handed out, 10 just didn't even try. Of the remaining 35, 20 reached that level. And the disparity, the difference between 20 and 21 was significant in the level they got to and the thousands of points less that they scored. What that did for us was it showed us who wanted to be in the class. They had access to whatever resources they needed to work through the material to get the points they needed. They had the field guide. They had hints. They could go off and do the Google searching and do whatever. But what it showed us, we had 20 students who really wanted to do this. And in this semester, we had 35 try, and we have about 15 students in the class. Same thing. If you look at the scores and how far they got, a big jump between those who obviously put in the effort, who wanted to be there, saw the value of it, and loved the game. Alan showed a couple of comments from students. I get the same thing. They still want access to the game. It was a limited time that they had access to it. They want to keep playing. They want to keep learning. The game taught them how to do things. So this was a very different set of students. Higher level course at Montgomery College. As you might imagine, if you're teaching English 101, students are there because they have to check that box. These students show up early. When our period together is over, I leave because I have another class, and they stay there and they continue to work. This is not normal. I'm extremely lucky to have this class as well as the other one I teach because it's higher level. They show up and they want to do the work. back to the point two, of the 28, 23 of them have A's or B's. There were a couple, then, you know, there's always going to be students in your class who reach that level because they knew enough to get there. But there were a couple who got there just because they know the stuff, and they got to level six, and they got to 12,000, and they stopped. They also failed the class because they got as far as they needed to go to get in. They didn't do much after that. They're the oddity. They're the rare student, though, out of this. So I spent 15 weeks going through the content there in the small box, the Linux, Windows, computing, networking, programming, and common alert attacks. In a 15-week session, this is a lot of material to get through to everybody. Most of them have had Linux and Windows and networking. In fact, it is one of the prerequisites, just so that I can help weed out some of those people who might want to just take it on a whim. We're not going to teach anyone to program in 1/5 of a semester. The goal is to expose them to Python and C and programming, so they can see the cons, how programs work, and work through those programs. But even though I've had experience in all of these areas, although my programming is mostly from college, I still remember everything. I don't remember last week, but I remember everything from back then. Getting through all of this is extremely challenging in 15 weeks in the traditional college course. What the game and what is coming next allows the students to go beyond just what's in the class. They can go off and work on their own. In higher ed, we call the format of this class is what is called a flipped classroom, where the students do a lot of work before coming to class. My expectation is that they will already have done some research, done some YouTube videos, done whatever to understand what they're about to do today in their labs. So I lecture less than 25%. I try to do it zero if I can get away with it, and just let them work on labs. But again, this is an awful lot of content to get into your traditional 15-week course. So what comes next is that those students will be available or have access to the EARN grant from the state of Maryland as part of the Cyber Fast Track. So these students have the opportunity, after going through this class, to apply for this grant, for this scholarship, if you will. Those who do well enough will be given access into two of SANS courses, 401 and 504. And the state will be paying for this. 10 of my students have already applied for this. Now, you may think that there would be more, but in actuality, from the fall semester, about 5 to 10 of those students already have or are in the process of getting a job with several of the agencies or private organizations in the area, in part because of this class, not totally, but in part. An important point here is that the state of Maryland, because of this particular grant, is making an investment here in those students, which is significant because they understand what it's going to take in order to spin up enough people to address the proposed or the alleged shortage of cybersecurity folks. So this is kind of what it looks like. Again, we use the CyberStart game to see who would get into the class. We work through the course essentials, the CyberStart Essentials course. As part of this grant, the next phase is for those who applied to be interviewed and talk with companies, at which point they will earn the scholarship, pardon the pun there. I don't remember what EARN stands for, but and then they get these immersion courses at SANS, the 401 and the 504. While we have and had to have a prerequisite for the course, both James and Alan talked about this, how individuals who are capable of doing this do not necessarily need to have any IT or cybersecurity experience. There are a significant number of fun challenges students learn while doing the class. The CyberStart Essentials course really just augments that, and in all honesty, I could just have them work through the game through the course of the semester, and they would get this knowledge that they need in order to get jobs. I think that might be, yep. I think that's it. Is there something you'd like to add, Alan, on this?
Well, we're going to open it up for audience questions now. Any audience questions, you can come up to the microphone. I've got a question I'll ask Joe and maybe James to kick things off. I'm curious, the people coming into this program at the start, are they thinking of themselves as going after security careers, computer careers, or what's in their mind is the career they're going after?
Well, in our case, it's definitely cybersecurity. We have a cybersecurity program. We market this cybersecurity program. We tell them that there's 20,000 jobs in the DC, Maryland, Virginia area, and you're going to, I guess it's false advertising. We tell them they're going to make a lot of money, like six figures to do this. So they come in thinking they're going to be in cybersecurity.
I think for the programs that we've been involved in, it's a mix. You know, there are absolutely people that are looking for a path to master more cybersecurity skills to get into the industry. But there's a huge tranche of people that had never considered this as a profession. They did it because it was fun. And as a result now, they're learning more because it's fun. We're almost building a hobby and then surprising them with the fact that it can become a profession, which I think ultimately in many cases does sometimes produce better people, but it certainly brings in a much larger number and much more diverse group of people.
If you guys aren't going to ask questions, one of the I used to chair a conference in Berlin. It's very hard to get American speakers to go to Berlin because in Germany the rule is if you disagree with the speakers, you can be quiet, but when you go back to your school or your office, you can't disagree with the speaker. So I bring these American speakers over who thinks she's going to ask a nice question, and she says, "That is the stupidest presentation I have ever heard." And then she goes on for there. And so you're next.
Go ahead. Yes. Oh, dear.
I don't know if this is working, but my name is Barbara, and I'm with Texas A&M University. And currently I run a SAC, but we have student that we hire that we're training to be security analysts for the future. But I kind of been doing my own program, and first of all, I want to thank you, James, for creating something like this, and Joseph, for what you're doing in Maryland. I would love to do this for Texas, and how do I get this started in Texas?
Well, we'll talk to you afterwards. I'm actually blanking on his name, but we've been talking to the TAMU guy, so come see
awesome.
Me after.
He's probably my boss.
Yeah, probably your boss. So
but he doesn't do the training. I do the training. Yeah. He doesn't even know our students' names.
There's a big idea here. We've just been talking to two other colleges. Colleges are the worst environment, meaning best environment for security people to learn their job because every day is a new incident response. Is that unfair?
Oh.
On the operational side, yes.
On the operational side, it's just absolutely breathtaking. So what a spectacular intern development, skill development environment, if you start with the kids who have those natural talents. So we're just talking about how could we help, three other schools are just talking about the same thing, make an apprenticeship program inside colleges where all the kids who wanted to when they were freshmen would try the game, the ones who really loved it would actually go to the course online. They might even get credit for it, they ought to, we'll see if they do. But then you would automatically be picking off stars, and then what you'd be giving them is this hands-on, everyday, real-world experience that companies are desperate for. So I love the question, because I think you're actually the answer to, because you can't do internships in security in a bank when you're 17 years old, because the bank won't let you, right? They're afraid of it. But
they can see everything. I mean, we see all kinds of stuff at the university, but I have to make a point. We couldn't find students 2 years ago to even join the program to try to get a job with us. And we had a girl that started in October of 2016 who knew nothing. And last night at the SC Awards, she won Student of the Year.
Yeah, so good.
Nice.
In the spring, we had 88 applicants for six openings.
88
for six openings now.
Superb. Well done.
And you're a faculty member? A member of faculty?
No, I'm just a staff person.
So you're on the operational side of the college?
I run the internal SOC.
Oh, okay.
I was the first member of the SOC at Texas A&M, trying to get it started.
Yes, we've done that as well. We have a SOC at Montgomery College where we have all the internet traffic that comes to our campus is replicated into
the
SOC.
We're at the system level, so we see all 20 universities within the A&M system.
Yeah, we're not that far. We don't want to see the system level stuff.
So I was going to invoke Berlin rules. If any of you think this won't work, because I actually think this will solve the cybersecurity manpower problem in the United States. I think if every kid in the country gets a chance to play, and I think we can do that, and they get access to these tools through all the community colleges, and the states do the grants like Maryland is doing, and I don't think any state's gonna say, we're not really interested in that. So, and they're already giving all this money away for things that aren't getting people good jobs, so it's not like you're asking for new money. I don't see that doesn't solve the problem. So that's when Brumley gets mad at me. So there's a guy back there who wants to talk.
Okay, we got time for one question, then
I think he's gonna do an answer.
Slot's over.
I don't have an answer, but question for you guys. Has there been any experiments with this with more like mature students, like
yes,
you know, over 30 years old or possibly even older? And
do your
second part of the question is there a way to get access to maybe pilot something like this? Like we're training people in a rural area that are brand new to cyber and kind of experimenting that way. And just curious if there's a way we could all try this out.
So, I can brief Jonathan.
Yeah, do it quickly.
Well, at a community college, two-year school, we have students that are fresh out of high school to people who are looking for a career change or just trying to better themselves in the organization they're in. So I have students that are 18 and I have students that are, I'm gonna say old, but they're way younger than me still, you know, in their 30s. And this works across the gamut. I don't think the age has much to do with it. Older learners, you know, they have to think a little bit differently because we don't retain very well, but we have all ages.
Yeah, I just add, we ran an experiment when we were launching these academies and doing retraining. We had age groups, you know, spanning kind of 18, 19 year olds up to 55, 56. So a huge, huge spectrum. And we decided to deploy the stuff we designed for 14 to 18 year olds to these adults to just see what would happen, with the hypothesis they'd become frustrated with the narrative and some of the gamified concepts. Actually, they loved it. It provided a lot of the similarity of on-ramp and confidence building and reignited their interest and passion in problem solving in a way that many of them, particularly older students, hadn't actually use those skills in quite some time.
Right.
And providing it's primed correctly, positioned, they were more than prepared to tolerate some of the kiddishness and get value from it. So we were really pleasantly surprised by how well it worked.
We got Alan, can you answer if someone's interested in how they contact about getting started and bringing this to their area?
There's an email like cyberstart@sans.org or apaller@sans.org, and we're working on most of the states right now. So we're gonna do this at the state level rather than individuals, because we think the states, the people trust the governors right now, they don't trust many other people, and not all the governors, but we think the states are the places that make sense. So we're gonna work through the governors, and so if you wanna bring it to Texas, that's the way we'll do it.
Okay, great, with that, we're out of time. I'd like to thank our panelists, and thank you guys for coming.
That's awesome.